actually going to talk about the first couple publications I have out, in part because I think it's kind of a journey that's worth talking about that don't often talk about, and also what stopped me from publishing earlier. So for me as a PhD student, my research was on the university experiences of the daughters of single mothers, and I am the daughter of a single mother. I'm first in family to the university. How many other first generation in the room? A few of us, okay. And I'm from a working class background, including growing up experiencing homelessness as a family. And so for me, it's, when I say, so I am illegitimate is the start of my thesis, it's the beginning of my thesis, the first line of my thesis. And it's about legitimacy both in terms of birth, but also how I felt in university and how I kind of still feel in academia. I feel like someone's going to unmask me. I feel like I'm sort of wearing the clothes that I don't belong in. So I still feel like there's a lot of imposter syndrome when it comes to perhaps especially academic writing. And academic presenting in a room of this size. There's a lot of smiling faces, so that's fine. So for me, there was a lot at stake, and I feel like a lot of pressure that prevented me from publishing more than I wish I had as a PhD student. So the only article I got out as a PhD student was one I co-wrote with Dr. Emily Danvers, and two of us were about the same place in our PhDs. So it's a bit blurry. But it was a really great way to start the publication process, to write with a colleague who was about the same place academically, split the work evenly to meet often, to make sure the workload wasn't unbearable for one or the other. It was a really great experience. So in this one, we were exploring student activists and student engagement and the ways that student activism isn't always recognized as a legitimate form of student engagement. And this fit with a lot of my research as well as Emily's, because my work on legitimacy and the notions of legitimacy, and her work on critical thinking in academia, whose critical thinking is recognized. So that was a really great experience. And I think what was interesting thinking about that writing process also was the peer review process. So we were talking about student activists and the way that they got seen as legitimate, and we had a section on the student voice, and we were quoting from an article. And one of the peer reviewers was like, this is a nice quote, but this is a journalist, not a student. In fact, it was both. The person who was writing was a student involved in student activism as well as someone who published an article. So that was really interesting. And I think one of my big advice, my suggestion to you is to not always imagine that the peer reviewer knows best. In fact, they might often not. So just recognize that you have an expertise to offer and that you can counter. It did help us make more clear in our article, obviously, but just an interesting side note. After finishing my PhD, I co-wrote a grant with Professor Sheree Hoskins. Right before the anniversary of my viva, we were awarded £500,000 to look at the attainment gaps for Black and Minority Ethnic students and working class students, home students in the UK. It's part of a 5-university partnership. What was important for me, why I put up this press release, and it's a partial press release, was that while the grant itself has her name on it, because my name doesn't mean much yet, it was important for her that my name was mentioned in the press release, making it clear that we both did it together. And that when she does talk about the work that we did, she makes sure that the credit is there. And I know that doesn't always happen in academia. So many long late nights working on this. The blood, sweat, and tears was definitely worth it. And I've been leading that project since we were working on it about a year and a half ago. My second publication came out in March. It's part of a special issue, and I would highly suggest, if you're not sure where to start, if you haven't started yet, to start with a special issue. So look for calls for proposals to submit your abstract to or your draft to. I have two articles of special editions, and I find it a really supportive process. So special issues may be a place to start if you're not sure about full submission. I've put up, if you have a smartphone, the QR code, even if you don't have a QR code reader, will navigate you right there. It's obviously I'm lucky to read my article. It is out of my PhD, it's near and dear to my heart. My third article just came out in July, and that was also an interesting peer review experience. So this just came out, but I've been working on it for about 2 years, and this is a special issue, but that's sometimes how long it can take. And one of the peer reviewers, I was quoting both Vicky Trawler and Paul Trawler's work separately, and one of the reviewers was like, I do believe that you mean he, when I refer to Vicky Trawler as her and her work. So that was just a lazy peer reviewing, but hilarious as well for me to say, actually, I do believe Vicky Trawler is a woman. have a few more coming out, which is amazing and weird still. So I've got a chapter coming out later this year, or two coming out next year. And then I've got some publications in progress, some of them solo written, some I'm writing with colleagues. I guess I would say my best suggestion is to publish before you finish your PhD, if you haven't finished yet, if you can. But also to know that you, if you are experiencing imposter syndrome, you're not alone. So if you're feeling like, who wants to read what I have to say? Trust me, people want to read what you have to say. And it's worth, if you are intimidated to write alone, it's worth finding that a colleague you can trust to write together. So that's my experience so far as an early career researcher.
Really, the enemy of writing time. every morning, not much was going on. I kind of knew something happened at work, I could easily resolve it in the afternoon. You know, nobody was going to die because of it. So I was really quite disciplined in that way. And I think it's just been good staying as well. And then over the last year and a half, like I said, I've been trying to cultivate this enjoyment and this discipline. So a little bit more. As things get a little bit easier to get into a job and completing some modules and things, you feel a bit more sort of free in space. So that's the kind of narrative stuff for me. More specifically, during my PhD, my head of supervisor, who was not pressurizing her students into publishing, so I never felt that pressure, and I didn't publish during my PhD. I know it's, for some people that was, might sound a little bit foolish. I can't say categorically which way is better, one way or the other, but certainly for me, I just wouldn't have been in a position to get something very good published. Because it's qualitative work, and many of you do qualitative work. And with that, it just takes a lot of time, really, unless maybe you're coming to it slightly later. But for me, when I was doing my PhD, it was a very new subject to me, so I really felt it took me to the end of the PhD and handed it in to really know what I was talking about, so that then I could produce something that would be highly publishable. Having said that, I got involved in other things. I got involved in research organisations, the Association for International Comparative Education, which is where I met you, Ray. And I published on a small online journal about the Institute of Education at that point. So at least I got some kind of introductory experience to publishing. Now, I'm going to say something very strange here, and that is that I was very lucky to be unemployed after my PhD. So I had 6 months of not anything. Of course, I had a grant when I was doing the PhD, so I'd say. But that time was really good, so it was from December until July before I knew I was going to have some work. So I really used that time. As I said, that was when I felt I was more ready to actually write something out of my PhD. And sometimes it can help to maybe lock yourself into opportunities. So I agreed to go to a conference where I knew that I would have to write a paper, something extensive, a few months after that. So I thought, well, I'll be smart here. If you're going to have to write a paper or write a presentation or something, then why not turn that into an article or a chapter or whatever it is, because I knew I wasn't going to have an awful lot of time after that once I started working. So that kind of small level of accountability, I suppose, the world would not have ended if I hadn't done it, but for me that really helped, having that, even that little bit of incentive or knowing that somebody else is relying on me. Another thing that has helped me most recently is teaming up with a friend of mine who researches build time. She was one of the lucky ones. And I know that she's very good at writing, and she's very good at having the discipline of writing things that you love. She's very good, and she's a friend of mine. So I kind of asked her for a favour. I said, please can we have a little writing club? She didn't really need me, but I really needed her. She was kind enough to say, okay, that's fine. So actually, at this conference last year, we had our sort of inaugural club writing session in a cafe. And it's only an hour a week. Now, that isn't very much, of course. But if that's all you can spare, that's enough to get you started. And often you can find if you have an hour, it turns into something much bigger. But again, if you know that somebody else is relying on you for that, you're more likely to show up. Now, we don't even live in the same place, of course, but, you know, Facebook, 5 minutes to 10 on a Tuesday morning, are you writing today? Yeah, what are you going to do? Okay, do it. And I can just help you. It's a person who can help me. Since the PhD, I have published. I managed to turn the things that I was working on in those 6 months into decent articles. But of course, writing in journals, like Ian White can cover his ears now, writing in journals is not the be all and end all. It is one way, but it's not the only way. And I know, I'm guessing from some of you that you have had some other work experiences before you came into PhD or your career research or life. found was that there are lots of other avenues for writing. You just have to gear it in a particular way. So I started writing a little bit for Guardian Teachers Network, because I was talking about teachers and migrant children. And I teamed up with a teacher, a school teacher, who we could work together. So I was sort of thinking a little bit more high in the sky. He knew exactly what would actually happen in the classroom. And from even a smaller group of migrant learners and how you can include them in classrooms in England, even for the, from that, I mean, it depends if you think that this is any way important, but if you start to then look at how many times your thing is shared, you know, like you do with lots of other things. I mean, if I compare that to how many times my journal articles have been shared, you know, there's a massive difference. No, it depends where you're working, whether that's going to be valued or not. But for me personally, that was really valuable, because I really wanted to know that teachers were reading my stuff. Otherwise, it was kind of like, why would I bother? So it's just to bear in mind, there are other avenues. Journals are one, but there are other places where if you really want people to read your stuff and you're willing to change a little bit what you're saying or hear it in a certain way, then there are opportunities there as well. I think I'm probably around the wrong one. I'll hand over to Ian. Thank you.
There is a mass information out there, I'm sure, I'm hopeful you'll be aware of guidance on publication. And my career experience has been in journalism, which is in education since about 1998. And what we're about to go through, we reproduce faithfully on our website, which should be very kindly popped up onto the screen. So if you're going to take away one URL from today's session, this is a good place to start. It's one place on the website, there are many others, and a lot of the information and advice that it gives you, which is today's germane, not just the journal publishing actually, there's actually some quite key kind of advice here, which is applied to magazine writing, blog writing, etc. So, without further ado, now this is based on the advice of Professor Len Barn. Some of you may know of Len Barn, he was the family editor of the Institute of Social Education, Disability Society, and also Teaching and Higher Education, which is what Jessica has published here, which is a large journal. And it really is, you know, it's stood the test of time as well. So this isn't advice that's been around for a while, and I make no promise that he reiterates it again. Really, I'm going to provide 10 top tips. Now, there are more than 10 top tips, which is good and bad news for the perspective, but really, the main core of the how we approach journals publishing really follows the following eight, I think, with two, I think, just additional bits of advice through it. The hard yards is the first thing you've got to do, really. Familiarise yourself with the journals in your area of study. Really get to know who's publishing in them, when they're publishing, what they're publishing about. And if you're finding that your paper isn't aligned with any scope, so that should indicate to you that maybe this is a journal that you should sort of aim to. Now we get a lot of reports from editors in particular saying that you reject a lot of papers because they're simply out of scope in the journal that they're editing. So to be very careful, make sure that you remove the editor's step statements on those websites that most publishers, every book publisher should have. It should be very clear guidance on what kind of papers they're expected to see. Again, some guides that's germane to the public process of whether you have a style of writing or writing from, stick to the point. Try to be concise, so there are word limits attached to journal articles. Make sure you're doing word counts. Some journals take a little more picky pieces, 5 to 8 words. Some take more reflective pieces, for example, research papers, and that takes longer pieces. So, again, be prepared to look at how you might want to explain yourself either concisely or better length, if that's what the journal requires. Each journal actually sets out, you know, in my experience, there's a need to establish a body of knowledge. And around that body of knowledge is a community of scholars. Professor Pat Thompson, at the University of Nottingham, who many of you know, has also often comes to my mind doing this presentation, says, you're joining a conversation, so be prepared to to own yourself and the requisite kind of knowledge of information that allows you to join a conversation without wandering into a room with you. So again, that aligns with the paper might or may not be able to see in or out of scope of the journey of the sort of thing. That's what Jesse made about being misunderstood by the reviewers. Explain yourself as clearly and concisely as possible. Explain your methodology to make people know why you're going to do this research. And expanding acronyms and abbreviations. There's obviously a common vocabulary with scholars, but you may have a reviewer that's not familiar with your journalist, but there may be a sociologist, you may be a student, so try and meet them. Explain yourself as soon as possible. Also, the thing that Helen touched on there, that group of scholars going together in Pango Mighty, if you can try and adopt a critical frame, something you can read the paper before you put the
paper.
Use a critical frame if you can. Show awareness of the general reference to the economy of the country. Again, this is ties to the concept of joining the conversation. Show that you know your field, show that you're current. Make sure you're aware of the accomplishments. So it's not just easy to get somebody who's often a mistake made by researchers or scholars. There are things something that you need to be actively aware of, and then we get that good chance to accept. The original is very, very difficult to understand, the massive body of knowledge out there. It is very, very difficult to be original with the editors or the people we use to be able to build on that body of knowledge and establish as a channel. So, try to repeat it all in over. If you're going to address it, it is already existing. What's your take on being criticised and being building that ring of concept clearly? We get around about thousands of papers a week from business journals and books. But a lot of these papers do end up being rejected, not because they're not understand research, but they've actually been written before that the authors decided to join us. So it's really important to just reverse that process, make sure what you've got in mind what students are going to submit to before you actually write your first draft. You can adapt the draft to the journal. That's your papers, their journal, your book, your book, I've got the maximum of your book, and expect you to do that. So, identify those journals before you draft your book. Make sure that you know what the journal is expecting of you. Another thing says, which is going to be on my advice ahead of us, this is obvious, maybe, not to say, don't submit the same papers to one journal at one time. There is an ethical process to be followed here, of course. Paper to more than one journal. Somebody's reviewing time is being unfortunately wasted. Lastly, hopefully we get some more discussion here with the panel session, securing permissions for third party computer material. That's just a tip for post acceptance process. We have a lot of papers that get delayed because permissions have been secured. So to commit the image marks, use your pictures, be very careful. Certain publishers, certain organisations are very keen to pick up on the misuse of images. And also, Bob Kill, I'm trying to quite popular to see what this is. Apparently, Bob Kill and his agents don't like his work. So, it's very litigious, apparently. Allegedly. So really, I'm just going to summarise there. We have the author services site there. This is a small part of that site. There's a massive amount of information there. And again, other publishers do provide similar support to the guidance to you as we can do in Scotland. We've also got some guidance on our exhibition table there. But I would say that the website carries a lot more than those in the brochure. So please go and check. went on to set the past issue. So thank you very much.
How you can
identify where that's relevant in the literature. And then you're ready to start the draft, then you can draft that piece towards that publication. You might be, so as Helen mentioned, you might be doing lots of things out, it might be a different piece. Seems like the advice there is domain system for the advice as well, but make sure you've got an idea. But just like a publication strategy as well, working out where you're going to place your work, you've got your PhD, obviously that's a final signpost at the stage of it. You've also got the pieces you might want to create from that body of knowledge as well. So it might be something for, I don't know, the Chartered College's journal, Impact Magazine, for example. It might be for a journal, it might be a monograph, which is So there are other aspects of the PhD you can then look to see, okay, we can adapt the chapters to something else somewhere else as well. So don't just think of, it might be that you're under institutional pressure though for that journal as well. So in respect of that, look at where your piece of work fits with the literature in your area. And again, your peer groups are very important in terms of can see their opinions of where they place similar kinds of things. Does that help?
I think I'll echo that. And for me, I have a publication strategy in mind, which I keep getting asked to submit book proposals, and I won't be doing that before the ref, which I know anybody who's a publisher might be upset about. But I can submit 6 articles in the next year, you know, versus 1 book in the next year and a half. So I'll be, if anybody wants me, I'll be writing the book after the ref. Feel free. Don't ask who wants for my proposal, but I think having a strategy in mind, how many articles do you would like to get out next, you know, and a long-term strategy, because it takes so long to write, so it's not imagining the only reason I'll have 6 that I can submit in the next 12 months is because they're in draft form and most of them are co-written. So it's not like I'm like 6 every year, it's just knowing that that's going to take you some time, but giving yourself that time. And when I present, I usually also take that draft and start shaping that into something you want to submit with the feedback. I think that's really important. So I've got one of the articles I'll submit in the next 12 months is Mother as Monster. So looking at the ways that my participants talked about how their mothers were, single mothers were vilified when they were growing up either by society or by their family or by the media. But I've been shaping that since I presented it a few years ago. So I feel like giving yourself also the time to put it together.
Citing authors of colour and of minority groups. There are definitely journals out there which their mission is to raise that voice. So keep an eye out for those, because particularly in the sociological literature, lots of editors I work with who are very keen to amplify that voice as a minority.
I think actually to add on to that, I think having writing partners as well to keep you to challenge you. It's actually thinking about what Helen was saying. I agree, having someone to write with is important, but maybe also having someone to say to you, have you audited your citation list? Have you looked at who you're amplifying? Because if you're great, you journals did that more often. If they said, you notice that your citation list is all really white, you may only and stale. But it doesn't happen. So I think keeping each other accountable is another way to.
Well, if you have a question for Helen, I will also admit that I'm one of those people that really dislikes the writing process, and it always really reassures me when someone else agrees to that, because I think as an academic, too often we pretend we really enjoy writing, and it's our favourite part of the job, when really it's my least favourite thing. I'd rather be stuck in front of a lecture theatre through in front of me, talking about introduction pedagogy, rather than sat writing at my desk. So Helen, how do you motivate yourself to write that a bit more, or how do you keep going? Because it's something that I really struggle with. So what do you do to sort of get that writing process?
Fear? Fear is a great motivator, right? Well, that's not very healthy, a little bit of fear can be helpful. I suppose as much as I fight against the fact that citations and things are important and having SSCI, your stuff published in SSCI journals, taught journals and all the rest of it, I also recognise that you have to play the game to a certain extent, and I never feel very comfortable with that within me, but I suppose that's what it's like being a researcher. You're always kind of balancing good and the bad in your job. Yeah, I suppose it's just kind of having to accept it, and I guess that gives me the discipline. But I suppose recognizing that that also long term gives you opportunities, if you can think that far ahead. It's very difficult when you're in the PhD or just after to really think that far ahead, because obviously you're anxious about paying your bills and looking after your family or your own plans for your life outside of work. But I suppose I know now that I'm a bit more, say, into the game, that that is what's going to create opportunities in the future. And I really, really enjoy, another side of the job I really enjoy is the travel. Really, really enjoy that, and I really feel like I'm more myself when I'm getting to do that and meeting different people and things. And I know that from, you know, friends who work in very different jobs, is that it doesn't happen in every job, and a lot of people would kill for the kind of opportunities that I have got. So I suppose I recognise that that's a real privilege, and that's something worth putting a bit of effort into, even if I'm a bit uncomfortable with what that'll entail. Also, staying in bed and doing a bit of work can really help. So at night you're not thinking, oh, I have to get up for work. You know, that Tuesday morning, so Monday night I'm not thinking I have to get up for work. I'm thinking, no, I'm going to have to get up and go to the kitchen and make some tea, and then I'm going to go back to bed and do some reading and maybe a bit of writing. That helps. When you're in bed and working, it doesn't feel like work, so, yeah.
Maybe I need to work on my writing environment and we'll see that. Well, do you have any top tips to sort of engage in that process a little bit more reluctant?
Yeah, I mean, I think for me, I didn't at first connect with other academic writers because I thought it was really not my style of writing. It wasn't the writing that I did. I didn't see myself often reflected in a lot of the writing I was reading in journals. And then I started finding academics whose writing really spoke to me. I really love the writing of Sarah Ahmed, if you're familiar with Sarah Ahmed's work. And so that for me, I was like, oh, this is a different kind of writing that I've not seen before. And then there was a really important piece kind of formative for me even before starting my PhD that made me think I could be an academic writer, which was a chapter in a book called We Don't Need Another Wave. It was feminist writing, stuff about experience in academia and beyond. And it was called College, in the United States, College and University, yeah? So it's called, I went to college, all I got was this trailer trash t-shirt. So it was about a woman from a working class background, growing up really poor. And she was writing about her academic experience at a really exclusive elite university, but juxtaposing that with stories from her home life of her, they lived in a trailer and it would fall apart, so the floors were falling apart and deteriorating. So that kind of writing, really honest, raw, you know, creative, but still nonfiction, was like, this is me. And that's actually why I ended up writing my thesis starting with I Am Illegitimate. So I start with a story that placed me in my PhD to begin with. And it was the only place I could start. I remember when I was talking to my PhD supervisors about this. My primary supervisor, if anybody knows, Penny J. Burke, is an excellent higher education researcher, was like, yes, this is exactly what I want to read. And my secondary supervisor was like, wait, what if this won't pass FIVA? I was really worried that using that personal to start with might be detrimental. I did pass my FIVA, thankfully. But I understood her concern. But for me, I was like, this is where I start. And so I think it's also the motivator for me was finding my voice, not trying to use somebody else's.
This was Ruth's right, that sense of inner. There's a balance to be struck between compromise and asserting a position. And with the experience you go through peer review, you get being told stuff that you don't particularly like. It's a bit of a little, this is contrary to what I believe or my standpoint, but there is a, you have to be able to, and it will come through experience and repeated experience of submissions, that there is an element of compromise. You have to do that in order to get through that particular
moment. So. In my experience with peer review, it's helped shape all of my peer review experiences have been good so far, even the ones where they got it wrong. But only because it helped me shape and make more clear my point. So there was, in fact, the article in Teaching and Higher Education, one of the peer reviewers was like, this is great, but I don't think that single mothers are as stigmatized today as they used to be. And I was like, I will take that challenge accepted. So I added more writing to make clear that actually they are.
So I think, even though I disagreed, it forced me to be more clear on my position and to stand strong, but I had to write that in there. So it was, even though I'm like, how dare you, it actually did make me strong.
A good review of the work set.
Yeah.
You want to assert yourself clearly, concisely, and very tightly. I've done that, obviously, that was a success story for the purpose. So, yeah. Thanks.
Sorry, I know we're running out of time. But also, that's a really nice example. But more precisely, I suppose, to not give up if your paper does get rejected or if you get negative feedback. I was doing my PhD in education, as I mentioned, and then I moved into this area of migration. So that's it's quite a different field and very different sort of people writing for it, different names and all the rest of it. And it's taken me some time to find a journal that will accept my stuff or will get what I'm trying to say. So it doesn't have to be education journals if you're in education, is what I'm trying to say. I think now the journal that is now positively reviewing my stuff is Children's Geographies. Well, that fits with migration, but for some of you that might fit as well. And if you're really interested in showing the perspectives of children and young people, they're great. And the reviews I got, while I had to change a lot of stuff, that's been my most positive review, because the reviewer had the real balance of showing that she respected what I had done. I think it's a she. Showing she respected what I had done. No comment. But encouraging me to think differently and think in a more geography way, which was new to me, and I find that a really positive experience. It's been wonderful. Whereas before, I was being asked to change so much stuff, and I thought, no, this is getting away from the children's narratives that I wanted to share. So yeah, if she doesn't succeed, try again.